So for example, if you know my husband is always, I don't know, not helping out with the kids, you know, instead of coming at him in an angry way, trying to really understand what has led him to not help out or what caused that. So trying to understand his attitude and what caused that, and trying to understand and also keep in mind that I have a need and what is my need, and explain that to him and communicate that to him. So rather than take it as, you know, my husband doesn't help with the kids, it's because he thinks I have to do everything around here. It's because he thinks I'm a woman. It's because blah blah blah, and the list goes on. I mean, God knows how much I've done that. You know, I've gone through so much with my husband where, oh, you think it's because you work and I don't, then that's why you don't help out. So just trying to understand where their perspective is and trying to frame it in a way that this is my need. I need X, Y, and Z from you. How will you give that to me? And how important is it for you to give that to me? And in, when we frame it that way and just understand that this is taking ownership of these are the feelings that I'm feeling when my need is not being met, I think that helps in communicating effectively, whether you're a man or a woman. But I think, and this is going to be controversial, but I think us women are more likely to work on these things than men. But
It's
I think I'll
true.
come
It's
around.
not controversial. Women can change up to 7 times in their life, and men change moderately at best. So it is important to foster these things. And sometimes men don't make certain changes or certain life changes unless there's some type of I like to call it derailment or catastrophic failure. This might be this is the midlife crisis or this is a divorce, especially if he loved his family. And he's losing it now. He's like his core is shaken. I agree with what she said, Aline, and I wanted to add something or to share something with Brother Anthony regarding what he said. So, in the same way that we are requesting that women learn to understand how we communicate, we get to do a better job of understanding them. And this is where we step now into love languages. And understanding love languages, and that what it sounds like you were talking about is acts of service, right? How a lot of men, or traditional men even, do acts of service. And I like to compare that to telling your lady, hey, I don't like flowers, I like decorative garden stones, and she keeps bringing me flowers, right? So your lady may like, I don't know if you guys heard that. Your lady may really prefer, based on her life, right? She may prefer words of affirmation, right? And most of our love languages may come from a deficit, right? So it may be she wants quality time and words of affirmation. And for us, it's acts of service and touch us, right?
I leave that all tight.
No, we're not leaving. But and then there's gifts. There's 5 of them, and we all have them at a different priority. So for us, we may be hardwired to do some of these things, which is provide man, me provide. And you do these things to take care of the home. And some women love that. For example, I've talked to a lot of women who one of the ways they want to feel loved in the home is on the weekends, he takes care of the cars, he makes sure it's all filled with gas. And that's just one of the simple things she wants. And that may be easy for some of us to do. Other women may just want half an hour of uninterrupted time
Thank you.
for her to feel loved. You may be doing everything and even, helping to clean and cook, and you're tired. It's like, man, this woman is ungrateful. But all she really wanted, and if you read the book, by the way, The 5 Love Languages, they talk about this. She just wants half an hour of uninterrupted time to just hear her, right? And so she can vent and express from with you, not her girlfriends or anything else. And that is perhaps all she needs on a daily basis to have her love tank filled, right? And then for us, as we step into allowing ourselves to feel comfortable with feeling, we may find that simple things beyond cooking us, a meal, are things that really fill us up. I'll be complete by saying this one thing. I was 39 years old when a woman brought me to tears by fanning me.
You hear that, Reese?
Just fanning me. I've been so much of a doer, and I take care of things, and people lean on me, right? No one was really doing anything for me. And a part of that had to do with me. I usually don't stop. I just keep going. I'm a recovering workaholic. But I was in a workshop, and one of the things I was learning to do or was being taught was how to surrender, right? And let things happen. And it was combined a lot. A group of ladies came in, and I was providing, and we were moving around, so a little bit hot. So I took out a pamphlet, piece of paper, and I was fanning myself and the two ladies beside me. And she took the pamphlet from me, and she said, "No, let me do it." And she started fanning me. And I was like, "No, let me." And she said, "What, is my fan not good enough?" I said, "No." And she said, "Just surrender." And she took care of me. And that and a few other things she did, I can't remember the last time, you know, when someone really took care of me in that way, you know?
Yeah.
So it was a simple thing. And some of us, we're so used to just doing, even in the way we have sex sometimes, doing, we miss what it's like to be really taken care of. And sometimes in order for that to happen, we get to sit still and allow someone to come massage us. Go ahead. And I'm complete.
I love that you said that. And I want to jump and piggyback off of that a little bit, because a lot of us women who have been also workaholics for years and years and years, sometimes we may not notice that, you know, or we forget that we have to step back a little bit and do something like that. You know, we're used to taking charge and being strong and this and that, especially today, you know, even if we're moms, we are working moms. Yep. So we're handling 50 million different things, but I am so glad that you said that, because for all of our listeners out there, and I'm just taking a break to acknowledge everybody who's with us every week, they like to join us and listen in, and don't forget to make sure you're sending us your comments, everybody. So we forget sometimes to just acknowledge the men and acknowledge what they're doing. And I'm guilty of that as well, to just stop at times and just acknowledge what he's doing.
I say thank you.
Or just say thank you, you know, because we're going, you know, we're busy. So with that, I also want to welcome Reese. I'm sorry, because Cardin has been quiet.
I know. I was just going to say my piece and then let him jump in, because I just wanted to say, for me, I'm like, my love language is touchy, affectionate. That's me, right? And that's what I expect my man to do. Well, my man is not like that.
Can I say something?
Uh-huh.
So expecting is kind of like dreaming that it would happen. We also, as women, we have to communicate what we want to them. And I think that's something that a lot of us don't do. We just expect them to do it.
Exactly. That's me.
Yes.
You're supposed to know.
You should know.
No, we have to tell them, because they will not do it. So we cannot get mad at them if we don't tell
them. Too much work.
No, we have to know what we want, and we have to ask for it.
That's not how it looks on Lifetime when I watch Lifetime movies.
That's the problem.
Lifetime, Hallmark, and this and that. You're supposed to know.
You're supposed to know how the woman feels.
Yes. No. That's not how it works in real life.
And you see that I'm angry. You're supposed to do everything to make me
feel. Thank you. Why do I have to? I'm telling you.
We have to teach them. We have to communicate it with them. And I think, like, loving yourself enough to say, you know what, this is what I want, and this is what I want you to do, I think is the first step. Just acknowledging that this is what I deserve and this is what I want and I expect you to do this, I think is the first step. And I think once we get to that level, we're going to be comfortable exactly what we want.
I got to go back to class on that one. Jesus.
Yeah, right there. A friend of mine just shared yesterday, she's been married for several years, and she says she's still in her honeymoon phase. One of the things she does is, she says, regarding communication, one of the most important things, not just communication, but she makes sure she hears him and makes sure she's heard. And one of the ways she does that is, let's say she's in the kitchen and he starts a conversation while he's watching TV. She will not respond. She'll wait until he turns off the TV or pauses it to engage. And when she wants to communicate something to him, she will not engage if she's watching the TV. He does work hard. They have several businesses together. And when he comes home and he's relaxing, she wants him to relax. However, if they have something to talk about, she'll alert him. And then, you know, if you want to be heard, then you get to respect your own communication and respect the person's time also to say, hey, some people think it's ridiculous when I suggested it, schedule time to talk, you know, or say, hey, when you finish that, can we talk? And that way both people are prepared and they come prepared to listen and to hear. And when you do that, then there's a great big channel, an area where you can speak, communicate what you're, and ensure that there's understanding, and your partner, you can hear your partner and communicate to them that you hear what they're saying. And that leads to what she, Raga just mentioned, that no, men are not mind readers. Some of us who are more, I mentioned that 20-something percent of men who are better, more socially aware, some of us kind of understand some of these things, and we're very good at understanding, you know, touch, massages, simple things. Some of us are not, you know, so you get to communicate so we can know, you know, you want to go on a trip once or twice a year, communicate that. Let's set goals together so we can save up budget and make it happen. And guess what? You're happy. You said it's too much work. How much work is it for you to complain, be in your feelings, be upset for, you know, several, however long, many days out the week, not want to have sex because you're upset with him because he didn't know what you're saying, when all you had to do is say, babe, when you come home or when I'm home and we're finished at the end of the night or whatever, can you just rub my feet or hold my hands? How much that was, that 5 seconds?
So why am I gonna do it on his own?
He knows, because he doesn't know what you want, so, in that way.
So I'm gonna take a quick break right now from this discussion and remind everybody, if you guys are taking notes, which we love for you to
do, and you're next, Cardin.
Okay.
And yes, right after that, I'm gonna come to Cardin. And so if you're taking notes, everybody, I'm just gonna summarize a little bit. One that was mentioned is really know what it is that you want, okay? And communicate it to your partner. Both Ragged and Carlo talked about this today. Know what you want, and this is for women. Don't expect that the man is gonna know what you want and understand it if we're, you know, they're not telepathic. So know what you want and communicate it. I also like that Carlo mentioned, you know, make sure that you're being heard, right? Make sure you're being heard. Make sure he hears. That means you got to take a break. If you're cooking and you don't want to talk while you're cooking and you want to do the talking afterwards, do that. I love that. I took note of that. And the other thing is, schedule time to talk. That can be a little scary, because I know if my other half says, listen, I need to talk to you, all of a sudden my hair is going up. I'm like what? Yes. I'm ready.
It's not like that. It's not like that. You can it's not like that. My brother and his wife.
No, I'm just joking.
Okay. No, but it is like that.
But there are other people who are gonna be thinking that. So don't get on the defensive. You know, is the point that I want to make. Don't be on the defensive. Just open to knowing that maybe this is just a conversation. And with that, Cardin, I want to pull you into our discussion right now.
Yeah, pull him in. Pull him in.
Hold on. I'll just to complete what you round out what you just said.
Yeah.
Just like a healthy thing is date night once a week. My ex would call it, and my brother and his wife do this. It's a weekly heart to heart. So on Friday evenings, they sit in the living room after they put the kids away, and they sit and they check in, and not just sit, not watch TV together. They turn everything off and they sit and they talk to each other and really go deep, not superficial conversation. How are you? You know, and really get into it. And that's what it is. So the being heard, sometimes scheduling it, you can have a weekly check-in where you sit, talk to each other, reseat. That's when you can make sure you really get that foot rub or rub your leg or your thigh, and you sit there on the couch and really have that moment. These are where you can incorporate that. I'm complete. Cardin, how you doing, brother?
Oh, not bad. How y'all doing?
Good. Welcome to Let's Connect, Cardin.
Well, I appreciate it. My name is actually pronounced Cardin.
Cardin, okay.
Mm-hmm.
Cardin.
Awesome. Yes.
About that.
Oh, no, it's all right. I get it. No, I'm not.
Okay, so we have a food in Jamaica called sardine. I'm sorry.
Well, see, we have some unique names, just like Ragged and Cardine. So we have to get it right, everybody.
Get it right.
We're good now.
It's all right. Now, I heard a lot, and based off of what I heard, a lot of it brings, I resonate with it all. Now, I got a phrase that I use with me and my wife. We say that everything that changes grows, and everything that grows changes. Because before we got married, I knew she was going to change, and she knew that I was going to change eventually too. And you just hope that change is in a positive direction. And when you get married, I do agree that communication is important, but I also believe that when you communicate, you have to know your audience. So you have to know how to talk to that person, because if you don't, I think someone did say that the message won't be as clear. It'd be a lot of ambiguity. So to me, I have to know my wife, and I have to be careful on what certain words I use, because we call them triggers.
Yeah.
So when we sit down and talk, of course, you go through your arguments, and then, you know, when you argue, you come back, and then I tell her, if we didn't learn nothing from that argument was pointless. All that yelling and screaming, even though it was a negative situation, we still should have learned something from that. And what we do now is we make sure that when we communicate, we have that face-to-face, that no one is making any negative body gestures, you know, because you can communicate with your body. You know, yeah. Some women might roll their eyes and, you know, roll their necks, or you might make a sound like, shh. You know, you put your hand on your chin, you basically what they call a stonewall. So what we tend to do is when we have those talks, we'll make sure that, hey, are you ready? Are you mentally prepared for this conversation? And if you're not, we'll come back to it, because we don't want to have a argument that is worthless.
Right.
And my phrase to her is, there is nothing wrong with having a disagreement. We just can't keep having the same ones, you know?
I like
so
that.
I try my best to make sure that, hey, and she taught me this part, because I used to always try to figure out where are you coming from and try to let you know that that's not right. And she used to tell me, look, don't listen to argue, listen to listen, but at the same time, don't combat it, you know? Take what I'm saying and listen. Even though you don't agree with it, listen and try to fix the situation. And what she was basically telling me is, when we have these topics or these arguments, let's talk about it from a solution standpoint rather than trying to figure out who was right or wrong.
Right.
So, and Brother Anthony, you said this, and I just want to know if I'm the only one that as a man that has felt this way, and I'm trying my best to get out of it, but we were talking about love languages. And to me, how I express my love is spending my money. My money is attached to the love that I'm giving. Not saying that's a materialistic thing, but I feel like me getting up, going to work, paying these bills, and going out, spending my heart, earning money on you is a way of showing love. Now, she doesn't mind that, but I have a hard time letting the masculine side of me go in order to, and she uses the word vulnerable. And to me, that is me being vulnerable, me spending my money, you know? So I just want to know, has any other man ever felt like that, or if you were in that situation in general?
Real quick, but do you guys tell your wives, I love you, like love you, or mm-hmm. you do?
Oh, yes.
Okay. All right. So I thought that was like, you don't say I love you, but you'll spend money. think mm-hmm. that she'll think that's low. Okay.
It's something I also had to consider, that a love language could change. They could change after a few years. When me and mm-hmm. my wife were dating and we was engaged, it used to be gifts.
Yep.
You know, she used to love random gifts and used to pop up gifts. But after she became a mother, you know, we got married and, you know, our lives started to change. It was more about words of affirmation, mm-hmm. and things like that, because of her position and life change. Now she's a mother. Now she's a wife. She's not just my girlfriend and this and that. So now she has to be reminded, and I have to reiterate things of what she means to me and a good job she's doing. So I would say they change. It's not going to be that way forever. You know,
okay.
Mine used to be, I think mine is the same. Mine is always like quality time. I like for my wife to put the phone down, you know, because she's really always on the phone. So I like to be on the couch, put the phone down, put the phone away. And I noticed in the beginning, it was more of acts of service, but now I'm all about the quality time, you know. And mm-hmm. So I noticed mine changed a little as well. So I would just really tell all the fellas and the women that, hey, you can change. After a few years, depending on what new position they take on, what kind of role they have in life, it can mm-hmm. change.
That's why I said, I that's my phrase, anything that changes grows, and everything that grows is going to change, because you're not going to stay the same throughout your marriage. But I appreciate the feedback.
So what you mentioned regarding the money, mm-hmm. there are levels. So we talked about self-awareness and growth, right? The default or base level for men is, one of the ways men show fidelity to women is by giving her access to his resources, taking care of her, and providing for her, putting a roof over her head, or including her in his roof, and so forth, giving her access to that. That's one of the default ways. And then you build on top of that the love languages that may change, etc. But it is important to understand that. But also we get to grow and add some of the other things that we've been talking about, such as the love language. But yes, you are right. That is what most men are, the default that men do, because most men out here are not spending money like that on everybody, right? Mm-hmm. It's unless you have tremendous amounts of money and it's really nothing. It's just you go out and you're paying for dinner for everyone in your crew. But still, none of those people are in your home. They're not in your right. sanctuary. The woman you'll take to say, hey, you're with me, and provide the parameter for her, you know, among all these things. That's default how men show fidelity. So yes, that is what men do in general, at least traditional men. Mm-hmm. Modern men that are emerging, there's an imbalance there, and they are looking for a woman to take care of them based on how they were raised. And that's another conversation.
So, okay.
Ragged, I think you, did you want to say something? You were going to say something?
Yeah, I lost my train of thought. Well, I wanted to tell Cardin that his wife is really smart, because as coaches, something we always try to work with is having, when people are communicating about an issue, is recognizing these, what we call roadblocks, which is judgment and coming to interpretations and becoming defensive and having reactive emotions. So setting those rules is really, really smart when you're trying to communicate about an issue. And where the key is to have the issue being resolved, not communicate or not, you know, argue for the sake of arguing, like your wife said. So I really agree with that. And to the other point that you guys were talking about, gifts and how things change, I completely agree with that. I mean, my husband this past Valentine's Day got me a coupon book. I'm cooking all the time because of COVID. We haven't been eating out at all. And one of the coupons was for a home cooked meal, because I hate eating out and I'm like so tired of cooking. And I thought that that was the best present I have ever received.
Look at
because I need that, you know, sometimes I need that. And then a night off was one of the other coupons. And I love that, you know, he doesn't need to buy me things. But that was like my, and I needed it. But I think everyone is different, but you know, some reason he knew what I wanted this time, and he gave it to me. And sometimes, you know, for anniversaries or things like that. I'll ask him, I'll say, I want your professional time, you know, as a present. I don't want a present. I want you to be able to dedicate, you know, a couple of days, you know, you can take a couple of days off of work and help me with my work. And he does that. And that is the best present because, you know, buying things is really nice too, but sometimes we need more than that, especially if a woman can go out and buy her own things.
Yeah. So it's about listening again, mm-hmm. and to your partner. And I love that because Carlo had mentioned also before that the woman who just fanned him, that brought him to tears. So it's not always spending money, is just doing something that the other person is going to appreciate for you, is getting that coupon for a night off or something. That's amazing. And then when Cardine talked about, you know, spending money, I was like, I want to tell you guys a quick little story. It's a personal story. Here I go getting personal. Yeah. So I didn't understand this. And it's funny that Cardine mentioned that because it took me a while to understand that, because my spouse, one day I went to work, right? And here I go, the busy, you know, person doing 50 things. But then I came home and the entire, like, the house was rearranged, different furniture, just a whole bunch of new stuff. I walked in, I'm like, where is this? I don't know where I'm at. But I kind of freaked out because I immediately went to, like, wait a minute, why are we spending all this money? And da, 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 da. So I went completely to the opposite side, like, you're wasting all this money. Why are you spending? But I guess, as Cardine mentioned, that was his way, I guess, of expressing, you know, his concern for me or his love for me and this and that. So women, if you're listening right now, please take note of this. There are different ways that men are telling us that they do express their affection, and we can't always pounce on it because that presents a problem in itself. So there you go. That's my story.
And I'll say this too, with the financial thing, you know, we all know society tells us that the man, you know, we got to be providers, you know, we got to have it. And so when we are in a position that we're able to do that, you know, whether we want to admit it or not, it brings a certain amount of pride to us. Yeah. We can do that. We can go out and buy that. You know, so us doing that, we're prideful about doing what we're doing.
I didn't get
so
that.
If it's not accepted,
I didn't get that memo.
What is that?
No, I said I didn't get that memo. Sorry.
I mean, yeah, because, you know, look, society has always been, you know, the man, you got to make. We all know about that. You know, nobody wants to scrub and, you know, yada yada. We all know that narrative. So yeah. When a man is in position to, you know, I'm gonna go out and buy my girl a diamond ring, I'm gonna go out and buy my girl something because he could do that. You know, whether we want to admit it or not, it makes us feel good. And, you know, it feels good to our ego that we could do that. So yeah. When it's not really accepted, or when it's not really embraced in a positive way, it's like, yo, I'm this is what I'm doing for you is something that, you know, a lot of men wish they could do. So that's another reason why we do that thing. And that's why it's sensitive to us, because it's our pride that we are able to do that for you.
Absolutely. All right.
I think something to remember regarding that. Remember I shared with you last week that you said you didn't get that memo. Most men are invisible to women. Most men are invisible. You don't even see them. So when you're counting stats about men, you're not even counting the men you can't see. Men who can't provide, don't have the means, you can't even pay for a date, or the women, they don't even exist. So what he's pointing to is, you know, whatever his circumstance or environment is or was, men, in order to be seen by women, have to work hard to get to a place where women are willing to see them. Right. And if they're not able to do that, they don't exist. You know, this is why, you know, this is, well, there are many things that come off of that. Okay. You have, you know, there's many reasons for different things, but bottom line is, men have to work hard to be even seen by women in the first place. And when women are looking at men, they're evaluating for certain things, including stability, among other things. So when they have it, they're standing on it to say, here I am, because you may not recognize it, but the reason that you're even paying attention to him is because he has some level of stability. So in some ways, if you see him a little peacocking, like, yeah, babe, I bought you, you know, here's a little extra, like, here's the car or whatever it is that he's, it's because he had to work to get it. Whereas you, you're born, here I am, you know, and women have a different experience of life and dating. We see you from, it doesn't matter where you work or how much money you have, we don't care about that. But women care about what we have as men. And that's why, you know, it's such a big deal for a man to be able to do that, because he has to work to make it happen. Or else, look at her finger. Put your hand up again, Mrs. Goldstein.
My hand?
Yes, that one. You see that? Yeah. He had to work to make sure you can put a nice one on her hand. And so, and she's like,
that's right. Yes.
You know,
I'm just kidding. Well, that's what I was going to say, that some cultures, that is how you show how much you love a woman. I mean, I'm beyond that level because I'm, you know, I left my country a long time ago, but it's, this is what, you know, our aunts and mothers talk about. Oh, he loves her so much. He bought her this. Oh, you know, her bed is this much. Like, that's how, you know, some cultures define how much a woman is loved, by how much her husband or her fiance spends on her gifts and her, you know, whatever it is that he's offering her.
Right.
And not just the woman, but the men. Men also evaluate other men based on the type of woman he can have by his side. And the type of woman some men can get is based on how, what socioeconomic level they are at. So that's a whole other conversation.
Yeah, that is the whole. Well, in my culture, how successful your husband is also depends on how tall and thin you are.
Oh, well, that's another discussion too.
That is a completely other discussion.
Wow.
Now, let me ask you, ladies.
You wanted to say something?
Yes, ladies, let me ask you this. Based off of what we were just talking about just now, do you have a guy made up in your head that you have in your head that when you see the guy in front of your face, you're comparing to?
Yes.
You get what I'm saying? Okay, so there's a guy. You see, that's why I think we lose that. I tell my wife all the time, I say, hey, you're comparing me to a guy you made up in your head.
Yeah.
I can't meet those requirements. I just can't.
It's true.
Yep, that's Disney and a few other things that...
Yeah, Hallmark, like she said, Hallmark.
And oh, yeah. Listen, I don't like those channels. They set you up for failure. They set you up for so much failure, because by the time a woman gets to the age of marriage, I'll tell you this. One of the most scary things to the younger demographic, listen, one of the most scary things is knowing or understanding or the reality that for many women, it's more about the wedding.
Yeah. Ring, than the marriage.
The day, the dress, not about, no, than the man, than your partner.
Yeah.
And this is a part of why so many of those relationships fail by the time, if they get married 26 to 30, by the time they get to 33 or somewhere around there, it's ended, because they were more interested in heading towards the day. And they didn't really, this is not where we talk about the importance of self-awareness. She didn't know herself enough as yet to even choose a partner that's compatible with her, or even realize that she is healthy or not healthy enough to be in a relationship.
Right.
Some of that's coming from societal or family influences, pressure to be married before a certain age. And while some of it is valid in happening, but enough information and education is not being given to the importance of matching someone, or at least setting realistic expectations. So she's watching a lot of Hallmark, a lot of Disney, a lot of all this stuff. And as Cardine mentioned, there's this person in her head that is not real. And that has become more commonplace today. And I think this ties into the notion that some women have, that if they go off and get their education first, they're able to upgrade themselves so that they can have better options, such as these men. And that doesn't, that's not reality. It's not reality. And so if you go to Atlanta or Texas or any major metropolitan area, there is a a gaggle or a grouping of very pretty professional women who are single.
Yeah.
Because they have this list of what they want, this guy in their head, and they are now empowered mentally that this is what, and they're not settling, and they're not connected to the real stats that the amount of women they are, there's not enough men that match what they think they're looking for, or, you know, you're not located where this person is. And by the way, this type of man wants something which is a little bit more aligned with what Ms. Goldstein mentioned in some places, which is, you know, what your physique looks like. Because for some of these men, if they're white collar, when they go to these socialite events, these company or corporate parties, he is being judged by the way the woman on his arm looks and how she speaks. So if he comes there with a woman who is not intelligent, that's a bad look for him, and among other things. So that's a little bit down the rabbit hole, but these are some of the things. So that Hallmark and those things are doing women a disservice, and having these real conversations with from a healthy and realistic perspective is really going to help us do a better job of connecting with who we are and appreciating and not doing one of the current trends, which is dating somebody and waiting to upgrade, waiting for something better. A lot of folks are doing that also today.
So then what would be the recommendation against doing something like that then? Because a lot of us, and I love Hallmark, so I raise my hands.
Hold on real quick, Carol. Thought I was on mute. Sorry.
Yeah.
I just want to piggyback on Cardine before you get anything. There is nothing wrong having an image of what you want. Okay? You may not get realistic.
I get it.
I wanted to look up in my man's face, and I like the dark and, you know, all that. I ain't get that. I got far from it.
How did you feel when you did not get it?
There's nothing wrong with wanting to. Just like men, you guys, you're acting like you don't have the type of woman you want on your arm.
This is what men. This is one of the differences between men and women. Men accept what's available to them. When a man understands, here, this is what I'm saying to you. This is.
Do you agree with that, Reagan? I don't believe that.
Hold on. Here, this is what I'm saying to you. Based on what we can produce, what we can deliver, we know that's what is available to us. Now, if we want better, some men are going to lie to try and do that. But what they have to do is produce to make it real. So why do some men work so hard? Because if he has that vision in his head, he's not sitting and waiting for it to happen. He understands that, remember I mentioned before, in order to have access to certain type of woman,
you got to have that money.
You know, so men believe in hierarchy, right? Mm-hmm. We believe in hierarchy. So we rate everything, including women. And it's really simple metrics. So the woman who we rate as nines and tens, you get those if you have means, in their 20s, right? And so a lot of people don't even, you know, there's very attractive women, but you don't see them because they're off the market early. And what's left is women who are lower. And nothing's wrong with that because most of us are average. Nothing wrong with that. But that's what they're doing. When men have means, especially if they're born into it, you go down to where you see boats and yachts, who's on those boats? Men of means and pretty, pretty girls. You know, whether it's party girls or if it's an attractive wife, you know, let's look at Donald Trump. Donald Trump is a perfect example of that. Definitely. Where he has had several wives, but his relationships have been contracts. Okay. He has a one-child contract, approximately maybe a one-child contract with each of his wives. So the current one is Melania. That's a contract about 20 years. Okay. She's going to be there. She didn't sign up for presidency. She didn't sign up for two terms. She's not pretending. So you notice she doesn't hold his hand or anything. That is a contract for one child where she will raise a child, take care of that. He will provide her with all expenses and everything. And when she leaves, she's probably getting $20 million, right? But that's a man of means, right? And I mentioned last week about different types of marriages. some are economic endeavors, some are romantic. Men who have money like that, they can put situations like that, and their woman, look at that woman. She is in very, you know, you can say arguably she's in nice shape. She looks nice, she carries herself well, and that's what's going on. He can get that because, hey, this is what I'm doing, this is what I'm offering, and that's what's going on there. And a lot of that happens. It's some of those marriages, especially people in higher socioeconomic status, it's not love.
The business.
It's a business, and there we go. I'm
complete. People get married for love anymore. Mm.
Yes, they do. There's some that do.
Yeah. Huh? I say, I think there is. There's definitely people that still fall in love.
Look at what's happening in the world. I mean, today with relationships. Like, one minute you're married, the next minute you divorce. Like, you just got married 5 minutes ago. You know, like, you know, it's...
You just spoke on the reason why, one of the reasons why it happens. When we have unrealistic expectations about our partner, you get the person you get, and some people are not really satisfied. So things can fall apart, but this is why the recommendation is, let's get real.
I wish we could get real the first, like in the beginning of a relationship.
Self-awareness.
And I wanted to ask is, how do we get real? Because we can say, okay, we get real.
Yeah.
A lot of us are not getting real, right? Because we are watching the Hallmark and we are watching the Lifetimes and we're watching this and that. And we have our vision of sugar plums and all this in our heads where we want the tall and handsome and thin and rich and whatever. Yep. And a lot of women do have that. So how do you say, get real, snap out of it, girl? What is something tangible that we can tell them to say? Because
I'll let Ms. Goldstein take this one. She's into mental health and mental self-awareness. She can grab this one.
So yeah, so important to help singles, especially young singles, identify exactly what it is they want. And it goes beyond, you know, wanting someone tall and handsome. It's identifying things and characteristics and learning how these characteristics will show up in a relationship. So I want someone compassionate. Well, how will that show up for you? What does that mean for your relationship? So learning all these things, and really, honestly, it boils down to having a vision. So having a vision, my vision is to have, you know, be married with this guy who is nice and kind, and, you know, he has a stable job, et cetera, et cetera. So then working through how will each one of those show up for you in a relationship, and then dating based on your requirements. So that way you're not wasting time with the wrong people. You're not wasting 6 months with someone who doesn't meet what you're looking for. And you're also emotionally available for people who might fit what you're looking for. So learning to say no to what you don't want is essential in trying to find the one and having them meet all of your expectations and all of your requirements, and also knowing your requirements and being okay to say no to what doesn't meet your requirements, and also being authentic. So don't be afraid to say, I'm looking for someone who I want to be in a serious relationship with. I know now the dating culture has been such a hookup culture that people are scared to say, I want someone that, you know, I want to build a family with. So they end up, you know, dating for fun because that's what the other person who seems, you know, fits the bill for now. They mindless swipe, they date for fun, and they find themselves, you know, 2 years into a relationship with someone who doesn't even want kids when you want kids, you know? Yeah. So I think knowing what you want, dating based on what you want, being willing to say no to things that you don't want or people that you don't want, and stop with the mindless swiping. Just really be mindful about who you're responding to, who you're reaching out to, I think is the first step. But it all starts with knowing yourself and having this belief and love for yourself that you're worthy of this. And I think it takes work. It takes a lot of work to get people to that level because I think society and the dating culture has really just taken the intimacy out of dating, and it makes it really hard for people to be authentic and transparent, because it's scary to be transparent, but it really takes someone who loves themselves to be, willing to not lie on their profile and say, hey, I am curvy, and that's who I am. And if you're going to love me for who I am, you know, I might not get 1,000 people who click, what is it, swipe right on me.
Yep.
But, you know,
swipe up, down, left, right.
Some people will. Some people will swipe. And those are the people who you want to actually be in your life. You don't want to lie on your profile just so you can meet someone and then they look at you and say, hey, you don't look as good as you looked in your profile. So
that was 10 years ago picture that you have up on there.
Yes, be authentic, be transparent, know what you want, know how what you want will show up in a relationship. So when it's not showing up, you know how to get out and love yourself enough to get out and not be, not settle for what you don't want. So I hope that helps. I know that was a lot, but.
Well, no, it was good. Go ahead.
But a lot of people, I must say, do find love online. Regardless, because I mean, there's a lot of people that got married from, I know a couple people that I got in a relationship with online, but I'm crazy, you know.
Well, so you got to be careful about that. You got to be careful about that. In addition to what Ryan said, about just because you get in a relationship, there are people who are trauma bonding. You have similar traumas or you're familiar with certain traumas and you connect, and because it's familiar, your relationship works until some point down the line it falls apart, or it gets unhealthy, or it may settle into those trends that you are resonating with. For example, if you grew up in an abusive home, you may resonate with a person who has the same whatever issues that caused the abusive conditions in your home. So because you grew up seeing it, that was imprinted on your mind. So that's what love looks for you. I was just in a restaurant the other day, and I heard three generations were sitting there, a mother, her daughter, and the granddaughter. And the grandmother, the mother, and the daughter, right? Let's go there. The mother was saying to her mother, grandma, her boyfriend is staying with her and he's beating her. Do you know what the grandma said? She said, he's beating you because he loves you.
Mm.
In front of the grandma. Now, what does that tell you? It tells you, no, there's more to it than that. It tells you that this woman attracted or chose, let's say chose, because you attract a lot of people. She chose to be in relationship with a man that whatever circumstances was going to be abusive. And confirmation of that is her mother, who was probably in the same thing and listened to the advice the mother is saying. So she saw that growing up.
Yeah.
And so she grew up to choose the same thing. Right. And then here comes mom reinforcing that. And the granddaughter is picking it up. These things don't come out of thin air. So back to what Mrs. Goldstein said. It all starts with self-awareness. And this is not some people, if you're really focused and diligent, there are books that can help you. But you really should spend time with a counselor and a therapist to really navigate through some of this and get it out. You know, there are workshops that help with this also, if you are really into it, because even if you get to be at peace and accept yourself and then remove the blockages that prevent you from being your best self, right? So with everything Ragged said, Mrs. Goldstein said, the other thing that I'll add to what she said is, While you're going to go for what you want, you know, and it's really not superficial at all, you get to know what the type of person you want, what they want. Because you can, back to the being in your head, you can want whatever you want, this long list, if it's a long list. But if that type of person doesn't want, is choosing something different, then, you know, you're also setting yourself up for a pill. So it's first be at peace with yourself. Yeah. And what that's going to lead you to is something like this. You're no longer attached to a person. You will be more, what you're going to be doing in relationships is how you're treated. You enter into a relationship and you go into an agreement with a person to love you the way you're requesting to be loved. And you are loving them the way they are requesting to be loved. That adds everything everybody said before about listening to each other and everything. And when this person is no longer willing or able to love you the way you're requesting to be loved, you can bring it up have some conversations. And if they're choosing, because everything everybody's doing is a choice, if they're choosing not to, thank you.
Goodbye. Question. I have a question for you guys. Tyrese had mentioned, you know, Tyrese was married. He's going through his divorce. And he made a statement saying that how could men, black males, naturally know how to be something that they were never raised by? In other words, how can a man be a husband if they never had that around him, or be in a successful relationship if that's not what they were brought up with? Do you agree with that?
Yeah. I mean, a lot of males have never really had a great example of a good father, a good husband. But me personally, I know a lot of males who's been in that situation, but as they became an adult, what they did was surround themselves with other men they see doing it. I had a younger man in his 20s reach out to me, never met me, but he just felt like I was somebody he could learn from because he never had an example. So he reached out to me to kind of just sit and vibe and get to know me and build a relationship with me to sharpen himself. So that's one example you can do. So this young man, he didn't have an example growing up, but he became an adult and had the mind frame to say, you know what? I see brothers that are doing it. That's what I want to do. I'm going to build a relationship with them and ask for mentorship. So that's something that you can do right there.
Okay. All right.
Yeah, I agree. And these mentorship program, you mean he just saw you somewhere? Do you have something online where folks see you, or how did he come across you?
Well, my mentor, so I mentor the youth. I mentor young men, 8 through 17.
Yeah.
But this young man in particular just follows me through all the stuff I do in the community. I'm known as a husband and a father as well. And I'm always promoting that lifestyle.
Okay.
I'm always promoting fatherhood and, you know, being the best husband you can be, somebody in the community. And, you know, over some time, he just felt like I was somebody that he would learn from and receive mentorship from. And yeah, he's already 26, 27. So he took it upon himself to reach out and say, hey, I need some sharpening, brother. And that's how he came up. That's how he went about it. And I feel like, you know, if a lot of men took initiative and started having that, you know, take down that pride and be like, you know what, I'm going to go hang with that guy because he's doing exactly what I want to do. Well, I feel like I can learn from him. I can receive mentorship, wisdom from him. I'm going to go take him out for lunch and I'm going to pick his brain. Or I'm going to hang around him. If a lot of men have that mentality, a lot of men will really start improving as men, well, sharpen each other up.
They do. The issue is those of us who do that are not as visible as we could be. That's exactly the reason why I asked you the questions I did. What was your visibility? So he was able to see you. And because he was able to see you, he reached out. This is how men, ladies, this is one of the way men work. When you have an issue or you're feeling a way, you tend to reach out to your girlfriends and you guys talk. Right? When men have an issue, we don't talk. We usually handle it by ourselves. And if we do talk about it, we usually reach out to someone who we think has answers. So that young man saw you and he listened and has been observing what you did. And he says, that guy has answered, so I'm going to approach him. So expanding your platform, is one of the ways to bring that in. This is one of the things men do. Men prefer to be quiet about something until we have an answer, or, you know, because we like to deal with facts where possible. Generally, men in their masculine, that's how they're operating. They want facts, they want information, they want something they can process, and they'll reach out for it. So I'll keep it short in not go any further than that. That's how men work. So more visibility. This is one of the things I'm working on myself, but being more visible. But yes, that's why he reached out to you, because he saw you, he heard about you and saw that you were living. And also, ladies, men understand certain things. I can tell you this. When I first time, our good friend, Derek Jackson, the first time I saw him, I only saw 3 videos. I said, that guy's not telling the truth. He's not being authentic. And I left him alone. So here's an example. Then this man saw him and said, I can learn something from this and I can resonate because my mentor, that's how I chose him also. I observed when I went to visit him, I saw how his wife and daughters, I didn't know how he got work done. He's an entrepreneur of cereal and his wife and daughters called him several times throughout the day. One is in California, one is in Atlanta. He was in Florida with his wife and throughout the day, they just call him. That's awesome. The woman in his life reach out to him for guidance, counsel, among other things. And so when you see that, you say, all right, this is good stuff. I'm complete.
Yeah. I just wanted to mention real quickly, one of our listeners in the Washington, D.C. area, which, by the way, we are international as well as national with our listenership, that just wanted to mention, and it is a male, by the way, it's not just women. So, you know, we have male and females. Orlando out there in the DC area, shout out to you. He mentioned that compatibility was the focus in the past, right? Because we were talking about being compatible in relationships, etc. And love marriages are a European construct that has expanded worldwide, as well as divorce. Those are his thoughts and his comments that he wanted to share with us in this discussion today. So I don't know if you all agree with that. It's a European construct, you know, love marriages and all of that and divorce. You know, I don't know how you feel about that or whether you want to comment. But I also want to mention, and I want to remind everybody as we're talking today about self-awareness and being aware of your mental health in relationships, you know, I just want to remind everybody to be responsible, right? And be honest and true with your feelings, because a note that I took for myself here, many people, if you're having any mental health conditions or issues in a relationship, you may feel inadequate. You have some performance anxieties in the relationship. You have low self-esteem if you're going into the relationship that way. And for both of the partners, this is definitely going to lead to some sort of decreased opportunity for bonding and resulting in ultimately your needs are not going to be met, right? So then you also end up with this unhealthy codependent behavior. You know, so those are some of the risks that I wanted to bring out, because we talked about the other side of it and what are some of the signs and things you should be doing, but it's very unhealthy. So you have to be aware of your needs and going into a relationship in order to have a healthy relationship. You can't have these. Do you guys agree? Any comments on that one?
No.
No, you're spot on with that one. No, yeah. Nobody commented on the European concept. Was anybody going to talk on that or no?
Jump in. I'm not sure what they're trying to say. So they're trying to say the whole idea of marrying based on love is a European concept.
Yeah, that's what I'm getting from it, saying compatibility was a focus, you know, like in the past, maybe, but the love marriages are a European construct that has expanded worldwide, and so has divorce.
I don't agree. I don't agree completely with that. I mentioned last week that we're coming, where marriage is concerned, the initial marriages were an economic endeavor. Mm-hmm. And then, especially in higher-ups. And I also mentioned something that we're not factoring in is that there was no middle class before, okay? Mm-hmm. What introduced the middle class was the Black Plague or bubonic plague in Europe. And in America, what introduced the middle class was after, I think, World War II, the GI Bill and some of these things. You're either really rich or really poor. Never forget that. Rich people want to stay getting richer, and folks who don't have means need to get out of their way so they can find a way up. Although they're in their way. Being broke is very, very expensive. I carry on. So the nuclear family, which is the wife staying at home, for people who are not rich, the GI Bill over here brought that. In Europe, what brought that is, what is it? The plague wiped out, what, 2/3 of the population? Or is it 1/3? A lot. So people who owned businesses, who wanted skilled labor, that was scarce. So if you wanted to get Jack to come work for you, you had other companies competing for his work, you had to pay him more. So now he's working enough money so his wife can stay at home and not have to beg, or the kids don't have to beg, or whatever may happen. This is that. You have farmers. So here we go with it now. Farmers and people with land and other resources and skills, blacksmith. One of the ways they, now we're going to talk about the marriage. You have economic endeavors or resource endeavors. How we consolidate power or have peace agreements is we marry, right? So you have land and he has land, or he has ore that I need to continue making products, or I want a lower price, whatever it is. I'm going to marry one of my sons to one of your daughters as a sign of good faith and relationship. There's a dowry, among other things. What would happen there is affairs. So you had love through affairs in these type of arrangements. And what you also have where, when we talk about marriage, for, well, so that's people with means and some of these other things going on. Below that, if you didn't have anything and you loved somebody, you wanted to be with them, this is marriage. Right? But it was a little bit different. This person didn't have much means, didn't have much money, but they really loved each other and they wanted to create family together. So these marriages were always there. They were always there, but the rules were a little different because people who are poor don't really have any means. And if dad's not around, well, actually the most you'd have is if they're able to, there's a dowry. But if you're broke and they're broke, her family and his family's broke, there's no dowry. You know, there's people getting together for that. Now, what we did have is in many cultures still going on today, Africa and other places and Europe and Europe and Asia, back to people with means. The more means you have, the more wives you have, or you're able to have, I should say. You know, this is one of the things that was happening in our culture here. We're not, that's monogamy is what they're pushing, is the order of the day. And, you know, it's, if people are doing anything and having second families, is usually done in silent until, you know, dad dies, has a funeral, and then you meet all your brothers and sisters you didn't know about. So it's always been happening. And it's not a European thing. European may have been more, no, it was across the globe, just like slavery didn't start in America. It's been going on across the globe, among other things. So I, from understanding those points and understanding how history and what do you want to call, not paleont, I'm sorry. Well, understanding how things have progressed, that's where I'll say I disagree that it's a European concept. Divorce is going to happen when people are not getting along. Divorce is going to happen when people have unrealistic expectations, or when people don't have the tools to maintain or contribute to a healthy relationship. So if someone is unhealthy within themselves, he's abusing his wife or the wife is abusing him, there's a problem. If he keeps gambling and not taking care of the family, you're going to have a problem. And sometimes things will fall apart and she will eventually leave and go back to her mother's house or things of that. So divorce, separation, they've always been there. And mental health issues have always been there. But when we get to heal these, we do a better job of choosing our partner. And we also do a better job of keeping the relationship together.
I'm coming. Right. You know, definitely. So our listeners are commenting, sending a whole bunch of comments to us, and we love it. Thank you guys for commenting. And they're just talking about, you know, as we're chatting, they're also agreeing with what we're saying. And some folks are agreeing that having a dowry and stuff like that is not a love marriage. You know, they're making us know what their views are.
Yeah, it's not. It's not a love marriage, but that's happening in Africa also. In Africa, in order.
It's not just Africa. It does happen also.
No, I said all over the globe. It's
happening. Middle East has a lot of the arranged marriages. India has a lot.
Yeah.
I do follow a lot that happens.
Even with the arranged marriages, I mean, it started out as a business, but they end up loving each other.
Not always. A lot of times they don't end up loving each other, girl.
Yeah, yeah. I don't know. I don't know how happiness. I've always said I'm gonna do research on that, on whether arranged marriage ends up in happy relationships. It's definitely less divorced, but happy, I'm not sure. I have to do some research on that.
Less, okay. Maybe I should have been in an arranged marriage.
I don't know if your personality wouldn't work.
You trust your mom to pick someone for you?
Right. And I think that also happens a lot in China as well. You know?
Yes, yes. I'm
familiar with them too. So it happens there.
And you know, I'm a reality junkie. Married at First Sight.
Oh, that's your show.
I love that show. And it worked for some and it don't work for some.
So just like you said there, it still boils down to healthy people. You have some men who are really not good people. You have some women who are not good people.
Yeah.
And it, you know, all the little things we spoke about, you know, if, again, check out our good friend, Donald Trump. I say that facetiously. But look at our friend, Donald Trump. No politics here. He is not an affectionate man. So when you see him try to, when Biden comes on stage or Kamala comes on stage with her husband or Biden with his wife, they're holding hands among other things. And then you look at Trump and he's trying to hold Melania's hand. She's not positioned for that because that's not a part of their situation.
I wouldn't marry that man if the man said, give me $5 million for business and I'm the poorest person. I would not. And that's what I'm saying. Look at him, right? And
that's you. There are women
who saying like, yeah, oh my God, like really?
Ugh. Yeah. That's you because guess what?
Let me be poor. I'll be poor for the rest of my life.
So this is where we have
because a situation. You have standards and values, and that's what how you want to marry someone based on standards and values, and that's what leads to healthy, happy relationships and lasting relationships. It's core values.
Oh, yeah. So what you're looking at there is she has an end goal in mind, and she is all relationships are agreements, right? When you go, some of us don't understand that we need to do prenups. Prenups are not just to, protect money. It's, here's a relationship and we get to have an agreement of what's going to happen in this relationship. What are my yeses? What are my noes? And we really get to think about that, but many of us don't. So anyway, you have situations here where she understands what she is doing is more akin to what power couple, where they say power couple or even royalty, or as I said, higher socioeconomic status people do. Okay, there are folks who are from China and Japan over here in the US. He's living in New York. She's in Philadelphia in a penthouse. She's taking care of the kids and he's making money. And she doesn't care to stay with him. She is, it's arrangement. And they make sure their kids go to the best schools. She handles all of that and he makes the money. Sometimes some of it is akin to duty. I want you to think about something, Reese. One of the things we look at in our communities today is that we are not focused. We are not heading in a singular direction. If you look at the Asian community, they are very strict. Even the Jewish community, they have rules. Now, all of them are not following them, but they operate in a certain way. They operate in where they have rules for how they manage their money. They have rules for how they do other things and rules for how they choose. In our communities, we talk about what does it mean to be a little bit more financially stable? It's having 6 months income, right? Well, no, in some of those communities, it's 3 to 5 years of income. Mm. So it's a different game. And in order to keep that going and keep them at an economic place of power and also make sure their kids get the right knowledge base, you got to do certain things. And if we're running around saying it's about feelings, we're not even aligning ourselves to talk to each other, to even structure ourselves up to go ahead and compete with these other communities. We're not. So yes, feelings are great and healthy relationships are important. And we also get to understand that we have a duty to ourselves that if we want to go continue to raise and do better, we got to do a better job. You know, look, finally, not to go too far off. Listen, look at Miami. Cubans came over and they beelined directly for politics so that they could put policies in place to support themselves. What did we do? Jamaicans do a different thing. You know, we're kind of silent. We own a lot of stuff and we're silent. Most of the movers and shakers who are people of color are from Jamaica, but we're not moving together. So we are thinking about how we feel, but we're losing as a community. And we envy some of these other folks. And what do they have in common? They have rules that they're following. They are keeping it like this. So they have their arranged situations and they have things that they teach their kids and their community. And you look at it, Chinese people, what are they doing? They have the list of businesses that are easy and that they know how to do. And they have generations of knowledge that they pass down from mother and father to child. But yeah. With us, we constantly are breaking apart. We're not communicating. So we can never combine and start moving in one direction because feelings. I'm complete.
Feelings. I don't know. I do like the feelings though, because I like to feel good.
Oh no, I agree. But we get to do it. We get to do it with a mindset.
Feelings are good, but you have to do it with your head and heart.
I think that when we are in a relationship or married, we should, you know how you go to the driver's license, then you have an expiration date and you go to renew. I really think that we should have the option of after 20 years or after 15 years, you come together and like, do you want to renew this contract? Do you want it? And you know what I'm saying? I think that there would be less divorces and less animosity, because I'd be like, listen here, Carlo, bro, it ain't gonna work for the next 20 years. We gonna, you know, we're not gonna renew.
Honey, yes. Honey, a healthy relationship, you do that every day. Yeah, there you go. You do that every day in a healthy relationship, every single day.
To see if it
works. And you have the option. You have the option with that. You can, it's a divorce.
Divorce, I'm telling you, it just, I don't know.
No,
I don't know, people outgrow each other because they've been together forever, like high school sweethearts. How they last long? You have one couple that last 65 years, they married 65 years, when some of us can't even do 7 years.
I'll tell you how. So making sure that you continue to improve yourself and continue to have new hobbies and continue to live a separate life than your husband or your wife. So it's okay for me to say, look, I want to learn how to play tennis, or I want to learn how to salsa dance, and I want to learn how to salsa dance without you. And then getting together and then just continuing to thrive together by him being curious about what I just did this past, you know, three classes or whatever. Mm-hmm. And then just learning from each other and just keeping that chemistry going. I think you can do that. I think it doesn't have to be boring, and you could continue to be intriguing to each other. If you continue to improve yourself and work on yourself and expand outside of the marriage. So not everything you do has to be together. And so I think allowing yourself to expand outside of the marriage opens that up for your husband, wife to have something to learn about you.
I always wonder what is the secret to these long-lasting relationships that I see, as I said, 65 years, 50 years. I know it's not easy.
Not being in your head. What she mentioned is spot on, and understanding that just because you're in a relationship, you don't stop being an individual, right? I talked about date night. I talked about heart-to-hearts on a Friday night, on the weekend, but also taking time for yourself. To go out, you may have a healthy circle of friends or things you like to do where you don't have to do everything for yourself. You know, that's another way you can strain your relationship, where you require each other to do everything together. Go out and breathe and remember that you are an individual, and a healthy individual who is can contribute to their part to a healthy relationship. That's crucial right there. The other thing is getting out of your head. Guess what? You know what grandma is not telling you? Some grandmas are not telling you that there were several affairs in that relationship. Okay? There were several affairs by both of them.
My grandmother.
Exactly. You said that with your neck, which means you don't know. So here's how it works. I remember I talked about biology. It's important for us to understand. Young people in their 20s do not know who they are. They don't.
They think most, they do, but they don't.
They don't, exactly. I've mentioned to you last week that men, sometimes the adult brain for most men, unless there is some trauma they had to deal with, like dad died and they had to step up, right? Or something like that. It doesn't turn on until they hit 30, right? Initially I used to say, people don't start to really have a good idea of who they are until about 32, right? So what that means is in the 20s, it's rough. It's rough in the 20s, which if two people in your 20s are dating each other, it's going to be a rough, rough time. There's going to be some heartbreak. Somebody's going to cheat. For some young men, they don't know what a good woman is. Yeah. They think that all women are the same. Right? Mm-hmm. They think all women are the same. True. So they may think that this is the way to go. And he may, well, I'm with her. Let me see, you know, what's that? So he may break up with her because this girl is starting to give him attention, not realizing she's only with him because of he had a girlfriend.
Yeah.
You know, because that's a whole other thing that some women do. So there's that happening. And then some women, this is something that some women who are pursuing career and education do. They'll have a good relationship through college, and they met that lawyer guy in one of the classes who's going to be a lawyer. And when she graduates, she dumps the guy she's with. So it's a real interesting mix of stuff that's happening there. So it's rough. So if a couple, let's say they met in high school or in college in the 20s, it's tough to navigate that together, really tough.
Yeah.
It's a tightrope. And if you do happen to make it out there, there's some things that happen. So by the time you get to 40, the kids are there and there's some other stuff. If she happened to not become super mom and stop being an individual and stop forgetting that she has a husband, or he, realized he had a wife, and he's, you know, and stayed, you know, keeping some form of romance happening there in the family, you know, then things could get a little shaky there. There could be some heartbreak, but they may have made it through for various reasons, right? She may be really traditional and she's decided, no, this is how it works. And she stays there because this is what she's going to do. He's not going to divorce her because typically that's not what men do. And then they go through and they make it through where all the silliness is out, right? The 20s are gone for him and her. And the kids are there. We've done a great job of getting them in school. They're now in college. Work is still happening, or career, or he's made some good advancements or whatever it is. Or there's some folks that they found a good niche together, right? Where they're balanced, there's peace in the home. And eventually they settle down. And that's where the companionship part really starts to ramp up, because maybe all the other parts aren't working that well anymore. Or maybe they are, you know, shout out to Viagra. And they're going together. And so they now go off into the sunset, you know, but it happens where when you only rely on feelings, I'm not knocking it, but when you only lead with that, you know, this is what feelings do. This is what feelings do.
Yeah, I agree with you. It
having us
feelings as well as
the respect for each other
that you talked about before. I agree.
You know what I noticed too? I noticed that the way a person was brought up has a lot to do with the relationship you have.
Yeah, that's why we talk about broken homes. There are it's, or,
let
it's
me tell you, yes.
Can I add something? So you mentioned that young people don't know, but just from working with young people and trying to help them identify what it is that they're looking for, I have a program called Mindful Dating. And more young people are actually willing to work on themselves and really define what they're looking for and go and have goals. They set goals and they want to achieve those goals. So I see that more and more young people are doing that. And I'm talking about, 24 to 28. I have a lot of clients who are within that age and they have a goal and they want to achieve it. And they want to have a plan for it.
When they work together. Yes. Are they working together or separate?
No, separate.
Okay.
Separate. So, but they want to learn more about themselves. They want to have that self-awareness. They want to work on themselves. And I think it's this generation. I don't know if COVID has anything to do with it, but this generation is on that track. You know, the mindfulness, the self-awareness. They're on that track.
Have you seen an increase because of the COVID with the dating?
Well, I've seen an increase in dating help. People are now hungry for real connections and meaningful relationships. They're tired of the mindless swiping. Yeah. They're tired of dating five people at the same time, which I never recommend. I think you should be emotionally available. I think if you're someone is worth you getting dressed and leaving your house for, then you don't need to have three other people backed up. I think it's the distraction. So
yeah, and it's confusing. You have too much choices.
It's confusing. Yeah, people are overwhelmed with how many available apps are out there. They're overwhelmed with how many, you know, people you have to go through just to find one person who might actually be interested in a long-term relationship. So yeah, people are really hungry for it right now.
Mrs. Golson might resonate with this. When you are on your self-awareness journey, the work that you put in to improve yourself will guide you in not just sharing yourself with anybody. The other thing it does is it causes you to resonate on a different frequency, and therefore it affects the choices you make, and it affects who is attracted or who will come into your circle.
Absolutely. Right.
So if you find that you're dating people and you don't like what's showing up, it means there's some work you might need to do on yourself.
Yeah.
Right. That's it. So we've said it throughout, peppered it throughout the conversation.
Yeah.
But it's very big. Self-awareness and really taking care of your mental health, okay, is crucial in you, A, knowing yourself well enough to choose someone that is compatible with you, as the person in the comments mentioned, compatible with you on various levels, and you having the tools to have healthy conversation so you can hear each other and therefore navigate the variety of fun scenarios life is going to throw at you.
Yeah.
Right. So this is what it is. So I think she'll resonate with that. So if you if you want to have healthy relationships, start working on get in contact with a therapist, and start reading. There are great books out there that really help with this, but get in contact with
a coach.
Yeah. No, we need coaches because we don't know, and it's important to admit that you don't know. So get in contact with a coach that can help guide you and challenge you, keep you accountable on some of these goals so that you can emerge your better self. And then when you go to date, you have no interest. Last episode, I told you I'm not on any dating apps because no mindless stuff for me. I'm very purposeful in what I do. And, you know, it shows up in the women that come into my space. I'm very mindful of what's showing up and who they are. And I can see the progression. I can see the change. So when you become aware that you are accountable of who you choose to bring in your life, and you are accountable for at least 50% of the outcome of your relationship, you want to put a little bit more work in there to make sure you have everything you need to be successful at your relationship. And I'm complete.
Yes, and accountability is so important. So if you've been in a relationship for 6 months and you know, the person didn't turn out to be what they seem to be, instead of blaming the person and saying, he just wasted 6 months of my life or she just wasted 6 months of my life, really looking at yourself and taking accountability for the role that you played during those 6 months, that will allow you to make changes in the future. Yes. Have a plan, recognize some of these things that were red flags in the beginning, and it will prevent you from making that mistake again. So rather than, you know, blaming someone else, which if you blame someone else, then it's out of your control.
Yeah.
But taking accountability will bring control back into you.
That's right. So accountability brings
power. I'm glad that you said that because our listeners right now, hopefully you guys are taking notes as we mentioned. And if you take away one thing from this episode today, I want you to take that note. It is a very big one. And we've talked about it the entire show. And I just want to reiterate it real quickly. Don't want to repeat the whole thing, but be accountable. Take accountability for what you do in the relationship, because sometimes, a lot of times, the problem is you. Yeah. So we have to look at ourselves to say, wait, how am I communicating? Why was I with this person for this long time? What was happening that was good and what was bad? We really need to look at ourselves. And a lot of times we're not doing that. We're afraid of what we're going to find when we look at ourselves, you know, people. So we really need to sit down and make that big note. Another couple essential things I want to mention real quickly, reiterate rather, because we talked about it before, but if you're taking notes, write it down in your notebook. To have a healthy relationship, besides going to the coach, because number one, yes, get a coach. If you're not sure what to do, get a coach. Like Ragged here, she's a coach. We need to give her information when we're done, so you can reach out to her, everybody, okay? And she'll be happy to help. So some of the things that we mentioned that I like, besides being accountable, is also get out of your own head. Okay, get out of your own head all the time. You want to have, Carlo mentioned before, that you want to have, it's not all just about feelings, feelings, feelings. Okay, we've got to have some sort of structure as well, but also knowing what you want. And that goes back to looking in deep inside yourself and coming up with a plan. Know what you want from out of the relationship from the get-go, from the word go. Know what you want, and not just know what you want, communicate it to your partner so they also know what it is that you want. That brings a healthy relationship. Communication is key. Write that down. Communicate, communicate. Respect is a very big one as well. You have to have respect for each other. We all have differences. No two people are the same. So it's going to take, Reese asked about that marriage that lasts for 60 something years. It takes respect, because you have to, you're going to be different and you have to work on those differences. A marriage is work. It's a job. Carlo mentioned that it was a contract. In other words, yeah, it is a job.
So it sure is.
People are very, very different. It's never going to be just peaches and cream every day. Okay.
It's a rewarding job. So yes. I know you spoke about mental health earlier, and studies over and over show that people who are in happier marriages or happy marriages tend to have positive mental health situations, yes, compared to people who are in unhappy marriages. But also, being single is better than being in an unhealthy or unhappy, yes, marriage.
I was going to mention that next.
And there's nothing wrong with being single.
Nothing wrong.
Nothing wrong with it, but it is better for your mental health than being in an unhappy marriage.
Yeah, or unhealthy marriage, yes.
Yes, and also in your relationships, someone mentioned it before as well, set boundaries, people. Sometimes you gotta set boundaries, okay? You have to set those boundaries. And there is nothing wrong, as Ragged mentioned before also, there's nothing wrong if you have separate things that you like to do from your spouse or your significant other. Okay, there are some boundaries. Okay, listen, on Friday nights, I'm going to go out and for a walk. And this is my walking time where I reflect and blah, blah, blah. This is a me time. That's what I'm doing. So there are some boundaries. And you've got to have trust. Okay, otherwise it's not going to work. And you must have support. Support one another. Maybe you have different goals or whatever. Support that goal, because it breeds a healthier type of relationship. All right. And I just want to end it off by saying toxic relationships are, for lack of a better word, bad. Yeah. Okay. I'm just going to leave it right there. Nothing fancy about it. It is bad. And we just want, what's toxic is people who don't support each other. If you're having conflict all the time in your relationship, if one person is seeking to undermine the other in the relationship or one up each other all the time, you're competing against each other, disrespect and a lack of cohesiveness in your relationship, that is a toxic relationship. So I hope that you wrote down some of those things. Look at the relationship that you're in, whether it's an online dating situation or it's a in-person relationship or a marriage or whatever. Take a look at those issues. And if you're experiencing any of those, it is toxic. All right. And you want to get away from that, and you want to reach out to someone like Ragged. some coaching. Okay. So with that, I just want to give both of you a chance to have a final say. So Ragged, if you, I don't know, Carlo, do you want to go? I'm going to let Carlo go first, and then Ragged, you can finish it off and give us all your info. So Carlo, if you could just give us a final wrap up.
I think one of the ways I like to define toxic is not knowing when to stop.
Okay. Yes.
Okay. It's, if something is not working and you haven't figured out, or you don't have the tools to make it better or to navigate it in a healthy way, it's time to stop. But beyond that, we have a lot of education or miseducation, and Brother Anthony pointed out that there are folks who reach out for help, right? Someone identified him, saw his resume in the community and what he was doing, reached out for help. Some of us have access to that. Some of us don't. But the same thing here would be Mrs. Goldstein here at Ragged, who is a coach. And sometimes we need coaching.
Yeah. So
allow yourself to go and reach out for those things and really take the self-awareness mental health journey seriously, because literally your happily ever after depends on it.
Yeah.
I'm complete.
Absolutely. Thank you for that, Carlo. And Ragged.
Yeah, I just want to end with a quote. I forget the philosopher's name, but it's basically, knowing others is wisdom, but knowing yourself is enlightenment. And so work on knowing yourself, follow, be authentic, and be true to yourself. And don't be afraid of doing that and staying true to yourself. And I just want to say thank you guys for having me. This was really fun.
Absolutely. Same here. We loved having you all on the program today, because we love to enlighten, to use your word, our audience. And we tell them to come take notes, you know, because that's why we're asking you all to come on, because you all have a lot to share with them. So we want them to get something out of every discussion we have here. So we thank you. Now, Ragged, please tell us where they can find you.
So they can find me right now. I'm on Instagram. I am working on my website. So my Instagram is Coaching by Goldstein. They can reach out to me, and I'd be happy to talk to your listeners.
Absolutely. Is there a telephone or just your IG for now?
No, I can give you my telephone number. That would be great too. So it's 661-400-3456.
I'm in need of a coach.
Oh, yeah. I'd be happy to help you.
Yes. I need help.
A lot of
yes. Reach out to me. I'd love to work with you.
Oh, my God. So is coach the fancy name for therapist?
No. So we are not therapists.
Okay.
So therapists kind of look back at what happened in the past to lead you to have these behaviors.
Okay.
With coaching, we are goal driven. You have a goal, you want to achieve it. We define and learn together what are some of your roadblocks and what's standing in your way.
Gotcha.
And we help you get what you want to get in life and help you have the happy, healthy relationships that you deserve.
Great, great, great.
Excellent. And we're going to put up your information and your link to your IG link and your number, so that if folks who are interested in getting some coaching and setting some goals and relationship goals and what you need to do, if you need help understanding, you know, or defining, because nobody can define who you are for you, you know, you have to do that work yourself. But Ragged with the coaching can help you to get to that point with, you know, asking you your questions or whatever goal planning she'll set for you. So we'll put the information there for you. For that. Okay. So with that,
all right, perfect.
Thank you both for
coming through.
And we will keep in contact with you all. And I hope you'll come back when we have some other topics.
Absolutely. We'd love to.
Indeed.
Thanks, guys.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.
Oh, yes. Another love good it. Show. Another good, oops. Another good show.
Absolutely.
Yes. They broke it down in the relationship department.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. So, I mean, we talked so much that, oh, my goodness.
Every week.
every week. But you know, this week we stretched it out even longer this week because we had a lot of amazing guests.
Yes.
And I really just wanted them to have the floor so that they can share their expertise and their knowledge with everybody, and it's not just us talking as usual. Right. You know, I like to say that.
Yes.
I just wanted everybody to benefit as much as possible from the discussion.
Yeah, and I think we did. We did. Yeah. We delivered.
Yeah, I think so. I enjoyed it. We dug deep. Got comments as well from our amazing audience.
Yeah, I said we have a listener in Washington.
Yes. Yes, and New Jersey as well. I was getting comments from New Jersey. I was getting comments from Washington, D.C.
Nobody loves me here in Florida. Nobody loves me. It's all good.
And we have people on our live who are rocking with us. So
I saw that Mark was rocking with us live.
Yes.
Saying that he loved our show. Thank you, Mark. Please share.
Yes.
Please share. We are, you know, every week we come with something different. Sometimes a heavy topic, sometimes a light topic. You know, you never know with Carol and Reese.
Never know. Never know. So,
and as always, we always want your comments. If you have any suggestions of a show topic, we'd love to hear what you guys want to talk about.
Every time. And jump in. We always, like we say, we welcome you.
Yeah, you can come. And also,
you guys are co-hosts.
Come on Zoom and talk to us. Let's, you know, let's vibe, let's connect, you know. Absolutely. So that's what we want. Eventually you guys can jump in, you know.
Yeah, we welcome it all on this show. Because we're not just here just because me and Reese, yeah, of course we love talking, but we're not just doing it just because we want to talk to, you know, like I say every week, we can talk to each other just by getting on the phone.
Yeah.
So, but that's not what we want to do. We want to talk to you. So call us and comment. Yep. We love it.
Yep. So yeah, it was a good show this week.
Always. So, always, always a good show. Yeah.
All righty. So right now it's 5:30. 5 minutes. I'm going to put on a little bit of music so we can kind of drink some water because we really, like, you know, did it today. People, you're going to hear music. We're not leaving. We're just doing a 5-minute music break so we can get some water. You guys can, you know, and then we wrap up the show. All right.
And don't go anywhere. We're here until 6 o'clock, everybody.
I know, Carol, people, you know, they don't like to hear music.
Yes. Our listeners, they say, because this is what they say every week. They're like, we tune in to hear you guys talk and hear the discussion. So when we hear music, we're like, wait, what's happening? This is what the show we came for. Because they love to hear us talk. How flattering is that, huh?
I know. So we're just going to take a 5-minute break. And we'll be back and we'll wrap up the show. All right.
So don't go anywhere. Come on back, people.
All right. We're back from that break. Yes. And I want to do a shout out to my Aunt Sandra. Hi, Auntie Sandra. I see that you're listening or / watching us. Thank you for coming through to the show today. So, Carol, you're mute. You're mute, honey.
So sorry. So sorry.
Okay, so
I was over here just yippity-yappity-ing and didn't realize I was talking while on mute, huh?
Yes, honey.
Yes, indeed.
So as I said, I don't know if you heard when I said that my aunt was watching. And as I said, we big up Mark. So I want to thank you guys. Every week we look forward to hanging out with you and all that good stuff. So yeah. So we have what, close to 15 more minutes before we wrap up. You can 15 more minutes before we wrap up. I'm sorry. I'm doing the show from my new spot.
Your new location.
My new location.
Yes.
People coming in, so forgive me.
So plug your new location, my dear.
The E-Girl Work Bar. I just moved one suite over. It's much bigger and nicer. I have that when you walk through the door, you feel that, what I call it, the feng shui. Feng shui.
Yes. That's
a fancy word. But yeah, more and more people are getting to understand what co-sharing is, workspace. So, you know, I have a feeling that that's why I play that song. I got a feeling that business is just going to boom.
Yes.
You know, and
especially right now, everybody is stuck at home.
Yes.
People are like climbing the walls. They want to get out of that space. But they want to do it safely.
And I actually just put up an article on my page regarding the future of co-sharing workspace.
Okay.
Very good article. So
there you go. And right now, that's what you have. That's what you're offering. E-Girl Work Bar, E-Girl Friday Work Bar. It is a work bar, which is, in essence, it is a co-sharing workspace. And it's a beautiful space, everybody. So you guys need to go check out the website, look at the pictures and everything, and see the space for yourself. It's co-sharing workspace. You're now getting a lot of people with different types of businesses.
Yes.
Who just want to have a nice space where they can do some work.
And you know, the good thing is too, you're networking while you work with, you're working with somebody for a different company.
Yeah.
You know, so that's the whole.
You never know who you're going to meet, but safely, because right now it's the COVID safety precautions that you do have.
Right. And we do have enough, you know, social distancing on that.
There you go. Spot.
So
you have the social distancing. It's a co-sharing workspace. I'm sorry. Got a whole lot of background ambiance.
No problem.
So you have the co-sharing workspace. So, and again, like we always say every week, sometimes you have a client that you might want to have a meeting with. You can't have the client come to your house. This is a spot that you can book some time to meet your client. If you're a small business and you know, your office is your home, you can't bring people into your home. So
that's where I come in.
That's where she comes in.
If you have to conduct interviews, I have a networking group. Actually, they're starting to meet up again after this whole pandemic. They're tired of Zooming. So now they're going to meet again physically once a month. And I have at least 50 of them coming in tomorrow.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's exciting.
Yes.
That's exciting. So for all of you people, like you just heard, so these are ideas that Reese is now giving because Reese has a work bar. It's a co-sharing space. It's a beautiful office. And you can go there and call up Reese and rent your space, book your space.
Yes.
You know, for, like she says, if you have,
you training, may, training, meeting, if you want to.
Meetings, interviews.
Interviews.
Meeting a client. Yeah. You have a business meeting. You have it there. Or if you just don't want to work at home, but you want to work outside.
Outside. You just want to get outside.
Exactly. Get outside away from your everyday space that you're in. You book the work bar. You book your space at the work bar. You come in. If you have a pop-up shop.
Yep.
Event you want to have.
Event. Yes.
Right there.
Right. So. Come call me 954-809-4931 if you want to come and see the space.
Can you say it again? You said it real fast.
Oh, 954-809-4931. And you can come in for a tour.
Come in for a tour, or you have the information on your website,
which is www.egirlfriday.com. V as in Victor, A as in apple.com, and you'll actually see a picture of what the space looks like.
Yes.
And that's that.
Amazing.
Yep.
So there you have it, people. E-Girl Friday Work Bar. We just plugged Reese's space that she has. Go book it today.
And I'm actually going to put the link on our website, on our page, that you can get an idea of what it looks like.
Of what it looks like. Absolutely.
And this is good also, sorry. This is good for people that travel too. Like you have companies that send their workers out, do a lot of traveling, and they need to meet up somewhere to do some work. You know, it's not only for local. You could be in Jersey and you're flying down here for some work purposes. And, you know, you can actually come in here and do work because I have a printer, scanner, all of that comes with your booking.
Wi-Fi.
Wi-Fi, everything.
Yes.
You can't get that at Starbucks. You can't get that at Starbucks.
That coffee and tea and all of that.
We do have Starbucks coffee and Dunkin' Donuts. Thank you very much.
You provide that too?
Yes, with all your bookings, you get coffee, tea, water, and snacks.
Look at
that. You get free Wi-Fi. If you need to print, you can print. If you need something to be scanned, it can be. It's like a business center up in here.
Nice. So
all of that comes with your booking.
Full-fledged business center that comes with your booking. And I love that you just said that because that's something I didn't even think about. If you are flying somewhere, maybe you're coming in for a meeting or it could be anybody coming into the area, but you need to meet someone, but you don't know where. Right. And you want to just book that space and have that person meet you there.
And just to let you know, my snacks are not no little Doritos and stuff. We're talking about... Peppered Farm Milano dark chocolate Fiji water. Okay.
Ooh. Oh.
Yeah, honey. This is how we do it around here. We're upscale.
Nice. Upscale meetings. So
professional
meetings.
Yes.
Yes. Love it. So if you have your client, like I said, you have a client you want to meet with, you can impress them by bringing them to that space. And it is not over budget. It's not going to break your budget.
Exactly.
You know, so check it out, people. I love that.
Yes, ma'am.
Very nice idea, my dear. So we are almost at the end of our show. I wanted to play real quickly because right now, the last thing we usually like to talk about too here is the voiceover piece. I am a voiceover artist. My name is Carol Tanya. The name of my voiceover company is called Lights Action Voiceover. And we give our guests a chance to talk about their businesses, et cetera. And at the end, we just tell you what our businesses are besides the radio show as well. And mine is a voiceover company where we add voice to audiobooks, narrations, documentaries, any type of business that you have, that's what voiceover really is. And I have a little video in here because I'm so tired of talking and explaining it. Maybe Reese, you can just play that video. right there. So I'm going to play two videos today.
Hold on. All right. Give me 1 minute.
And the one that's coming up now that Reese's going to play is really just an explanation of what voiceover is.
Hey everyone, this is Carol Tanya from Lights Action VoiceOver.
Not sure.
And I just want to pop in really quickly to chat a little bit about VoiceOver. Oh. And sorry. I get a lot of questions every day. Let me go back. Hey everyone, this is Carol Tanya from Lights Action VoiceOver. And I just want to pop in really quickly to chat a little bit about VoiceOver. And I get a lot of questions every day. People ask me, well, what is voiceover anyway? What do you do as a voiceover? That's the question I literally get. And I just want to say voiceover is really just adding voice to a narrative to enhance that narrative. And you could actually see this on or hear this on television, on the radio, on the internet, etc. So you're speaking over something, perhaps speaking over a video, and it adds to it to perhaps make it a little bit more exciting, to make it more informational. And just because you speak, for those of us who are speech enabled, just because you can speak doesn't mean that that is necessarily voiceover, because voiceover is actually voice acting. So you're really acting, right? If you have to project or portray something that you're supposed to be angry, then you're acting. Because if you're not angry right now and you have to read a script, you have to become angry. So that's acting right there. So it's really voice acting, right? And it involves using that tone that you have, it's using proper breathing, it's using proper spacing, it's using humor, anger, sadness, it's using all these things in your vocal range to make something exciting and fun. And for that, I just wanted to also mention a couple different areas of voiceover. Let me share with you real quickly. Like I said, it could be in film. You see someone sitting in a chair and they're thinking, but somehow we're hearing their thoughts, right? How are we hearing their thoughts? That's voiceover. And we've all seen that in different movies and different films. It could be documentary narration. So we watch National Geographic, which is one of my favorites, on BBC Earth, et cetera, the Serengeti, different types of documentaries. And that's the voice that you add to it. Animation, you know, we see our cartoon characters, et cetera. And there's a voice that goes with that. Could be audiobooks. You know, many of us today, we don't have time to sit and read a book, et cetera. Even though some of us still love to read the physical book. But that's adding voice. That's voiceover on your voicemail. That's part of what we call IVR, et cetera. What else can I tell you about? Podcasts, television, on the radio, that is all voiceover, promos and trailers, e-learning, corporate narration. So basically, if you have a product and you want to educate somebody about that product, whatever it is, it could be shoes, clothing, something for your hair, you know, accessories, you know, I love accessories. So whatever that is, you add voice to make it a little bit more exciting. Okay, there you have it. Was that a nutshell? Not really, but there you have it. Voiceover, Lights Action Voiceover.
Okay, and then the other one you said?
Yeah, we'll just close the show out with that. That really was this one, because we did today's show topic was about relationships and how self-awareness adds and helps your relationship, and your mental health awareness helps with that, because we are social beings and we rely on each other as human beings. You know, we can't be healthy unless we have a healthy relationship. So this other piece is something that I played before. It's called the Porcupine. And it really is just a story about human beings, because we are social. we rely on each other and what we need to do, how we need to stay healthy, just because we need each other to survive. So hit it, my selector.
Selector, all on here. Let me share the screen again so we can have our people.
You know, it might be the wrong one that I gave you.
Hi, everybody. This is Carol Tanya from Lights Action VoiceOver.
Hold on, we're going to take it back.
Hi, everybody. This is Carol Tanya from Lights Action VoiceOver. Let me do a little storytelling with you. When I was a young girl, I wanted to change the world. I found it was difficult to change the world. So I tried to change my nation. When I found I couldn't change the nation, I began to focus on my town. I couldn't change the town. And as an older woman, I tried to change my family. Now, as an old woman, I realize the only thing I can change is myself. And suddenly, I realize that if long ago I had changed myself, I could have made an impact on my family. My family and I could have made an impact on our town. Their impact could have changed the nation. And I could indeed have changed the world. You cannot change anyone, but you can be the reason someone changes. Carol Tanya, Lights Action VoiceOver. See you soon.
Boy, Matt, this is Reese with E-Girl Friday Work. I wish I could speak like this on a normal basis. It's so crazy. What? Yes,
honey. You know, it's funny because I get this every single time when someone hears me speak and do my voiceover. The word that everyone uses to me, and these are people who have never heard me do voiceover or anything, the word they use to describe my voice is soothing.
Yeah, girl, I was ready to like snuggle up. And I'm telling you, I wish I could talk like that on a normal. Oh my God, you make me want to go take some speech lessons now. Or some voiceover lessons.
Thank you. But I
always love to hear you. I always love to. It's like, that's just not you. Like, you're right. It's acting.
Yeah, it is acting. It's acting. You have to do different voices, different moods, because it depends on, and you have to, as a voice actor, you have to understand in your head what type of mood you want to create.
Girl, I can't even get out of this damn Jamaican accent, much less. Okay.
But anyway, that's the voiceover, girl. We're running over time.
Oh yeah, people.
Reach out to me, Lights Action VoiceOver on YouTube, Instagram, Facebook, all the different pages. And if you want to email me, it's lightsactionvoiceover@gmail.com. And the links will be on our YouTube page. So with that, we're going to close this out today and say thank you, everybody, for being with us. We love you, love you, love you. Come on
you
back.
You really don't want to go, but we got to go.
Yes, it is 6 o'clock, so we are done, people. Every Wednesday from 3 p.m. to 6 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, right here on myturnradio.net. So with that, our show is called Let's Connect, the show where you find...
More compassion.
Again, we are Let's Connect, the show where you find...
More compassion.
More empathy
and less
judgment.
Less judgment. Please don't judge me.
Bye, everybody.
Bye.